books of the Bible. There's so much instructions in the epistle as to how we should live our lives. So I get really excited about that. The book of Galatians was an eye-opener for me. You know, you hear a lot of people talk about legalism in the church. Well, if it was one thing that we learned from the church of Galatia, is the fact that there was a lot of legalism going on. And it's amazing how even those such as Peter, who walked with Christ, when he became among the Jews, sometimes he reverted back to the Jewish laws, which is what Paul had the biggest problem with the people in Galatia. They just, the Jewish, which he calls Judaizers, tried to convince them that they still had to come under the Jewish laws. So it's just amazing how even circumcision and the Jewish ceremonies and all that kinds of stuff with Paul started the church in Galatia, and he taught them, and as soon as he left the church, the Judaizers came in, and they tried to convince the Gentiles that they still had to live under the Jewish laws. And so it's amazing that Paul said no. Paul said that you are saved by grace through faith in Jesus Christ. Now this lift the burdens of the obligations that we had to do things a certain way. We had to say a certain prayer a certain time. We had to go to a church leader and have them pray for us. So all those burdens were lifted because we are saved by grace through faith in Jesus Christ. And you know, this wasn't something unusual. In Matthew 23, Jesus himself had to address something similar. He had the same problem. When he was speaking against what the Pharisees had done in the Second Temple, during the Second Temple period, he said, "And they tie up heavy loads and lay them on man's shoulders, but they themselves are unwilling to move them with so much as a finger." See, they were laying these burdens on everybody else, but they weren't living up to their own laws, but they wanted to put these pressures on the Gentiles. And Peter, in Acts 15, when he was addressing the leaders of the church, he said to these same Judaizers, "Now therefore, why do you put God to the test by placing upon the neck of his disciples a yoke which neither our fathers nor we are able to bear?" And see, we like to do that ourselves. We like to go out and put pressure on other people. See, because if we can continue to press down somebody else, and they don't see our faults. So we are just like the Judaizers, whereas we want people to adhere to the laws that we make. I mean, that's why we have so many different denominations, see. We go and we set up our bylaws, and we want to convince our congregant that it's the Bible. Well, it's not necessarily the Bible. Sometimes it's the rules and regulations that we and our deacon board, or our leadership board, have decided that if we're going to be Baptist, this is how we do it. If we're going to be Methodist, this is how we're going to do it. If we're going to be holiness, this is how you're going to do it. I remember when I first came to Columbia in 1979, I had some relatives who were members of Bible Way over on Piedmont. Not to say anything negative about the church, but the more important thing to them was I couldn't wear pants. I couldn't wear earrings. They had as many unwed pregnant girls in the church as any other church. But the biggest problem they had was how I dressed. Now, that had nothing to do with the Bible. That had to do with the bylaws that they had for their church. That was their rules. But I could see when I walked through the door that there were some other things in there that needed to be addressed that didn't have anything to do with whether I wore a dress or a pair of pants. And I had a discussion with this lady. She told me that they didn't wear pants, they didn't wear earrings, and they didn't wear this and all that kinds of stuff. And I said, "Is that your husband's shirt you're wearing? Would that perhaps be a man's garment?" And she said, but, I said, "No buts. If your rules say that you can't wear men clothes because pants belong to men, then you shouldn't be allowed to wear a man's shirt. And see, that's how easily you can get caught up in those things which do not matter. But as we move along, that's one of the examples of some of the things that I experienced. But anyway, and this is something similar to what they're saying here in both of the experience with Jesus and also with Peter, that they were focused more on putting a yoke, putting problems on someone else, and missing the whole issue of the fact that of their salvation. In our text today in Galatians 6, Paul sort of switches gears here. Usually Paul is telling us about what is right. And when we come up through Galatians and the epistles and several of the epistles in the Bible, he's telling us what is right. But in this book, he's telling us how to live. When we get to verse 6, he's telling us how we should live. He switches gears. He begins a series of teaching points which follows the arguments of the letter which address a specific issue in the church and his writings. That's why he addressed them as brethren to get their attention. Therefore, he wanted to make sure that he got their attention before he went to his argument about whatever the problem was that they were having there. So this marked the transition of Paul's letter. Paul is switching gears from what is true and teaching them how it should be lived out. He told them what is true. He gave them the truth. And once he gave them the truth, he said, okay, now I'm going to teach you how you can live this out. And the example of the Galatians, if salvation is by grace, how then do we live together as sinners saved by grace? Galatians 5, Paul tells us of what we can expect when the Holy Spirit is in control of our lives. And then in our next chapter, 6 flows out of that to tell us how we relate to one another when we walk in step with the Holy Spirit. See, we've got to first understand what it is truth and what it is that we're supposed to do. And then as we walk with the Holy Spirit, we're able to do that which we are supposed to do. In our chapter, he said, brethren, if anyone is caught in any transgression, and we all know that it's easy to get caught in transgression because we are not perfect. We live in a world where we was born into sin. When we was born into the sins of this world. So we could easily get caught up in a transgression. But caught in this case doesn't mean a ha-ha moment. It doesn't mean that I caught you. It's not an I caught you moment. It is not our responsibility to go looking for others' sin, hoping to catch them doing something that they shouldn't do. That's not my responsibility. God didn't give that responsibility to me. And Jesus addresses this repeatedly in Matthew 7:1 when he said, do not judge or you too will be judged. And then when Jesus met the woman caught in adultery, he did not just tell her the Ten Commandments and say that you shouldn't have done this or you shouldn't have done that. So he was giving us an example that sometimes when people are caught in sin, they're caught in discretion, it's up to us to try and help them the best way we can to get out of it. It is not our duty to police the sinner, to probe the church members looking for skeleton in their closet. It is easy to get trapped and entangled in sin. When we get stuck in sin, it's like quicksand. The more we wiggle and hide, sometimes we just get stuck and we can't get out of it. The harder we fight, the worse it gets. Some of the people around us will most likely get stuck into something that they shouldn't. Galatians 5 says, it is for freedom that Christ set us free. Stand firm then, and do not let yourselves be burdened again by the yoke of slavery. Sin is something that we get yoked to. We become enslaved to it. The guy who looks down his nose and say, I can't believe that he's caught up in that again. I can't believe that she is doing that. I can't believe that they, every time I turn around, they're just in trouble. Something's going on in their life. That guy needs to realize that sometimes when we get stuck in sin, we can't get out of it by ourselves. We need help. And he needs the freedom which comes through the power of Christ. Show him Jesus. Show him Jesus. You may be the only Jesus that a person stuck in sin may see. So you need to go to them and help them in the best way that you can to come out of the sin. The word tells us that we who are spiritually should restore him. Our responsibility is to restore them in gentleness, because sin requires a spiritual resolution. Dealing with sin, we should always have restoration in mind. In this instance, restore refers to repair or put in order, but can also mean perfect or make complete. Dealing with sin is not about punishing the guilty. We don't have the power to punish them. God didn't put us here to punish anybody. That's not what he wants us to do. The priority is reconciliation, moving towards making things right again. Getting that person back to where God would have them to be. Now, you understand in the fact that that person needs to want to get there too. So that's why you have to come to them with gentle and kindness. Speak to them in love. Not point out everything that they've done wrong. Because once you start pointing your finger, they're going to shut down and they won't hear you. So you have to handle them with gentleness, pray with them, give them an opportunity to hear Christ through your voice so that he can do the work. Because you don't have the power to heal them, but you do have the power that God gives you to bring them to a place that they will open up to him and he can speak to their heart. So that's what God would have us to do. God would have us to make sure that we are able to help the ones who have fallen. Decide to get side back with them to where they belong. How often in our reaction to sin that we describe gentleness? Have you ever, when you think about yourself, when you see somebody in sin or somebody close to you, do you handle them with gentleness? Or do you go to them and say, I know I saw you did this, you did this, and you did that? And a lot of times when you do that, before you get finished pointing the finger the second time, they've gone from beyond your ear. Gentleness does not mean dismissive to spare the person's feelings. Gentleness means that you are clear in your intent not to harm the person, but help. It means communicating in humility and tenderness. Respecting the fact that the person probably feels guilt and shame already. Now, there's some people that sin, they don't feel nothing. That's just who they are and that's just how they live. And sometimes they're a little bit more challenging than that person who feels the shame and understand that they have sinned, but they are so caught up in it, they don't have a clue how to get out of it. So we need to respect the fact that this person probably feels guilty and has shame already. Gentleness is how Jesus responded to those who have sinned. Now think of the woman caught in adultery in John 8, the Samaritan woman in John 4. Jesus says, hey, what you've been is wrong, but let me help you. I'm not interested in seeing you punished, but in seeing you made whole. When do you see Jesus get harsh? When we read our Bible, the times that Jesus got harsh, he got harsh with the church folks. He didn't get harsh with that dirty sinner, the prostitute that came in and washed his feet and dried him with her hair. He didn't get harsh with the tax collector or the adulterer, the pagan or the drunk. He didn't get harsh with those people. He got harsh with those church folks, those folks who got an earful of hellfire from Jesus are those self-righteous, arrogant, condescending religious folks. Those are the ones that he spoke harshly to. Those folks who were certain that they were right about everything and everyone else was wrong. That they were not the sinners, everybody else was the sinners. But we need to keep watch on ourselves, lest we too be tempted. When you go digging around in someone's skeletons, it rarely ends well. Be careful. Watch yourself. Do not watch them. They're already stuck. You don't want to mess around and let them get you stuck. They're already stuck. So you need to keep your eyes on Jesus as you help them. You need to be in prayer. If you end up stuck too, then you can't help anybody. You're just stuck. And we need to bear one another's burdens. One of the things when I was reading our scripture, I noticed that we are to bear one another's burdens. We're not to get worried and well-doing. But there's also a portion here that told us that we reap what we sow. So we need to be very careful in our lives as Christians as we help people. We need to be very careful the seeds that we sow, because we will guarantee that in our future it will be based on some of the things that we've done in the past. So we need to be very careful about that. So as we bear one another's burdens, temptations to say, hey, everyone, look at so-and-so's sins happens often. Or say to a person, you're evil. You're a sinner. God hates you. How on earth will we help anyone calling attention to all of their sins? How can I help you be free from this? How can I incarnate the love and grace of God for you? It is not my job to let them know how serious their sin is. My job is not to proof text all the ways that they have angered God. Jesus didn't quote the Ten Commandments that the woman that was caught in adultery. He didn't tell her to be ashamed of herself. He said, go and sin no more. He is saying, you can be free of all of this. And see, that's the thing. We are filthy, dirty rags. No matter what we have done in our lives, when we go to God and we lay at his feet and he forgive us, we can go and sin no more. And even when we sin again, because we're going to sin again, we just have to be in repentance to him. And he will tell us to drop the baggage. Don't keep carrying that baggage. You have people sometimes that come to the altar time and time again, and they lay all their burdens on the altar of God. And when they get up, before they get out the door, they've heaped that burden back on them. So we have to learn how to do not carry all of this baggage once we are free from these baggage. Once you come and help me bear my burdens, and you pray with me, and you read the word to me, and you teach the word to me, and I feel myself letting go, I gotta let that stuff go. I can't go back and pick it up. Fulfill the law of Christ. The law of Christ. Wait. I thought we had grace, not law. That's the point. We got to live out grace. We got to love the love, and we got to love ourselves, love our neighbors. There is no law. There's no law against love. You know, the disproportionate portion of this load bearing the burdens of others sometimes fall on the pastors and the ministers and the caring for the instruction and the instructing of the church. In verse 6 of our text, instructs those taught to share with those teaching. The one who is taught the word is to share all good things with the one who teaches him. This verse is for those whose foremost duty is teaching the word. Those who receive instructions in the word should share all good things with the instructor or pastor. All good things include material returns and our financial, biblical teachings, and ministers. The verb translate is shared as a command. The benefited should benefit those who benefit them. That's like a tongue twister, huh? The benefited should benefit those who benefit them. For if anyone thinks he is something when he is nothing, he deceives himself. Wow. You know, a lot of times we walk around here thinking we something. I'm sorry to be one to tell you, but we're not as holy sometimes as we think we are. You know, sometimes we think, well, I'm a lot more holy than you. But we're not as holy all the time as we think we are. We are not in the position to tell others how to live other than teaching them the word of God. Because if I go tell you how you should live and I'm not teaching you the word of God, then when I tell you how to live, I better make sure that I'm living the way that I tell you that you should be living, or you're not going to hear anything that I have to say. You know, the Bible tells us to first get the plank out of our own eye. Yes. Then we can deal with the speck in our neighbor's eye. Just remember, when you point out the neighbor's sins, chances are your neighbor can point out some sins too. And we do this, you know, does this mean that we ignore other sin? No. Just don't pretend to do it from a place of moral superiority. You know, don't go being so high and mighty when you want to point out somebody else's sins. When we get rid of the plank so we can help with their speck, mutual moral accountability can be a powerful thing in the Christian journey. Corrections, helpful if we give and take and none with the purpose of genuine desire to assist one another to grow in love and obedience. Humility is the key. For if anyone think he is something when he is nothing, he deceives himself. You know, we need to make sure that we understand that we don't go around haughty thinking we're high and mighty, that we know everything. Because, you know, the Bible from cover to cover, no matter how many times we read it, we're not going to understand everything in it. I may understand something a little better than you. You may need to help me to understand something. And that's how we have to grow together as Christians. We have to understand that we don't know everything. It is impossible. For us to know everything. It doesn't matter how much schooling we have, we don't know everything. You know, that's why when Jesus went into the temple as a 12-year-old boy and he was teaching, you know, those Pharisees, and they had all that education. Some of them had been spiritual leaders for years. And then this 12-year-old boy had a nerve to show up. And he could tell them some things that they had never even imagined. But that's because he is God. And he can do that. But I have sense enough to know that I will never know everything. And Lord knows this little brain of mine couldn't handle it if I thought I did. So I thank God that he has put people in my life to teach me. And he's also put people in my life that I can teach, and we all learn together. So we thank God for that. We thank God because we know that he loves us enough to make sure that everything that we need is right at our fingertip. And what I like about a cross style, when Dr. Manley teaches, when you get beyond yourself, when he first taught me that, I didn't understand what he meant. But if I don't ever get beyond myself, then God can't work in me. Because if I'm so full of self, he got to get between me and self. There's no way that I can learn anything, because self knows everything. So I thank God that he just showed me how I just have to get out of the way and allow him to do what he needs to do. But we just want you to know that let us, one, test his own works. And then his reason to boast will be himself alone and not in his neighbors. So you need to test your own self. Evaluate who you are. I don't have to tell you who you are. You know more about yourself than I do. So as we evaluate ourselves, we measure ourselves, and then we know who we are. But we're not measuring ourselves against your standards. We are measuring ourselves against God's standards. And God will show us where it is that we need to do a little extra work, where we need to do a little extra studying so we can get to where he would have us to be. And we just thank the Lord for that. And we just want to make sure that we understand that what we do today will depend on who we are tomorrow. Because the things that we did yesterday, sometimes they gave us a little hiccup. But we can't let yesterday hold us back. Because no matter what we were yesterday, it's who we are today. Who we are today, we can plan for where we want to be tomorrow. And God wants us to be in his word. He wants everything that we do, everything that we say, everything that we eat to be of him. And when we lean totally on him, then he will make sure that when tomorrow comes, we will be where he would have us to be. So we just thank the Lord for that. I thank the Lord for being here today. I thank the Lord for giving me the message. I thank the Lord because I have to come and speak every Sunday, that I have to study more. I thank the Lord that sometimes there's things that I don't always understand. I thank the bishop because he tells me to study, and the Lord will give you a revelation for what it is that he would have you to say. I thank the Lord because my son spoke this morning, and I'm so proud of him. He did an awesome job. I thank the Lord for him. I thank the Lord because he has put me a place in my life that yesterday does not matter. We just have to let it go. You know, the word tells us that we will reap what we sow, but the word also tells us that we can start today. We can start today. Today is the beginning of a new life. We can change today, and we can accept the Lord in our lives today. You know, sometimes we walk around, we've been in church all our lives, and it's one of the things I was concerned about my son, I was concerned about myself. You know, a lot of times children who grow up in the church, going to church every day, you don't understand sometimes that you have to accept Christ as your Savior individually. When you go through the traditions and the ceremonial stuff in the church, you're in church, you're praying, and you know, you've been a pretty good kid. You don't have any of those sins that you think are real sins. So you get caught up sometimes in confusion, not understanding, and it doesn't matter whether it's a big sin or a little sin. In order to get to where God would have us to be, to order to have an eternal life, we have to accept him individually for ourselves. I grew up as AME. They told us me that my sins were on my mama till I got 12 years old. When I got 12 years old, my sins was my own. So I had to go down to this mourner's bench and they had to tarry. I had to tarry for the Holy Spirit. But what I knew was when I got in fifth grade and they gave me my New Testament, I didn't know about the Old Testament, but I know there wasn't anything that I read in that little red book that told me I had to tarry for anything. It told me all I had to do was asked him. And I got a butt cut because I tarried, but I didn't tarry long enough. And when Friday came, because see, you only have a week to get the Holy Spirit, you start on Sunday evening. When Sunday evening starts, you come back on Monday night. Monday night, you don't get it, you got to come back on Tuesday. You don't get it on Tuesday, you got to come back on Wednesday. Then I'm old women singing, blowing in your face, getting kind of weary. Because see, all other grandma children, they done jumped up and shout. But what they don't realize is we plan in the back room who would shout on Monday, who was shot on Tuesday, who was shot on Wednesday, and who was shot on Thursday. And you had to get it by Friday, because if you didn't get the Holy Spirit by Friday night, you got something else. And I was hard-headed, and I know I say that every Sunday. I couldn't do it. And the reason why I couldn't do it, because I had already read my word. And my word told me that I didn't have to tarry. All I had to do was ask. And I knew that I had already asked him. He had already saved me. So why I have to go through the motion to be a member of this AME church simply because their doctrine said I had to tarry on the mourner's bench to get the Holy Spirit. But I want you to know today, right now, you don't have to tarry. All you have to do is ask. And when you ask him with a sincere heart, the one thing you need to know that once you ask, and you receive, you're still going to have some burdens in your life. You're going to need someone to help to bear those burdens. You will need prayer. You will need a good friend because, see, sometimes, You know, a lot of times people think because they're holy and they love the Lord and they don't need anything but Jesus. Sometimes they so heaven bound, there are no earthly good. We need somebody sometimes we need to talk to, somebody we need to pray with. We need somebody to help us sometime when we get caught up in our transgression. Because see, people will set traps for you. And they'll make sure that you get caught up. Sometimes you find yourself in something that you know you didn't do, but you can't talk anybody out of it. But you know, that's a whole nother message. I just want to thank the Lord today. I want to thank the Lord today and ask Bishop if you would please come up and do something. You just thank the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise God.
Run on, we'll finish.